I welcome all of you for the 10th webinar of Corporate Professional, which we are organizing in our Empowering Corporate World by our Knowledge Sharing Approach. You will be happy to note that all our programs, webinar, you are giving overwhelming support and participating, and this encourage us to organize more and more and better programs. Friends, what we are identifying, all the important issues which are happening in the corporate world during COVID era, and we are taking out that how we can solve this problem of corporate world and professionals immediately by giving our knowledge and inviting the expert on this issue. So today's program is very unique. It looks like this preferential allotment is a very simple thing, but now because SEBI has given various relaxation and the other bodies has given relaxation, on that basis it is a very buzzword today, and it is a very unique thing which every corporate wants to understand and implement it. Today we have three speakers. We have invited Girish Joshi ji from Bombay Stock Exchange, and we have requested him to share his thought that what are the issues which, when they are receiving application of corporate world, what are the problems, what are the mistakes people are doing. Second is, what are the important point he or his department is looking for, what are the governance issue in that particular thing which they are doing, and which cases they have rejected, and what is the reason which they have rejected or they are referred to SEBI for, because it is not fulfilling the requirement. So Girish Joshi ji will cover this part, and he is a very seasoned professional, a very expert entire corporate worlds and entire capital market rules regulation are on his tips. And we welcome you, Girish Joshi ji, for this program. Then we have Anjali Agrawal. She is his partner in Corporate Professional and looks after the capital market related things. She has experience. She has done more than 200 preferential allotment. She knows the problem of the corporate world, what are the issues and what are the technical things, and he will share the entire detail. And then we have a Manoj Kumar, who is a partner in Corporate Professional, and he looks after the corporate restructuring, takeover and insolvency. So Manoj has a unique knowledge and regarding structuring of and the takeover law he's looking after. He has done more than 60 offers and various advisory on takeover law. So he will tell us what are the issues in preferential allotment which are connected to takeover law. So I welcome Anjali, Manoj and Girish Joshi ji for this program. And the structure of the program will be like this. First, I'll give overview. Then Anjali will talk about the entire structure and the legal nitty-gritties. Then Manoj will discuss about the takeover aspects, PIT aspects, and the taxation and valuation aspects and FEMA aspects. And then Girish Joshi ji will discuss his detailed analysis of which I have just told you. So three speakers, and then we will have a question answer session. Anybody has any questions, they can send it to us. We have received few questions that we will give reply after their session. So we will have half an hour exclusively for question answer session, and you can write your questions. Friend, COVID era is affecting every business that you are aware. And the most important three factors are affecting money, material and manpower. And the most important effect is money, liquidity. And you know, liquidity and money is the oxygen for any business. And today in the COVID era, we realize the cash is king. And this is re-established fact. No doubt it was there, but now everybody is realizing that money is king. All business are affected due to, but listed of companies are affected more because of their unique reason. You remember, you know that unlisted company can take money by any form. Loan they can take, shorter, long term. Equity they can take from promoter, from outsider, and because their focus is improving liquidity. But listed company is unique and they have a problem. Loan they cannot take easily because they have to maintain their debt equity ratio, and they have to see that the market should not react that they are too much leveraged. Equity, they can bring IPO, but it is a long-term process. Right issue, everybody cannot subscribe. The best route is preferential allotment, where they can have a selected people can be used this. Now, in the equity also, the issue is rate. Second issue is who can take. Promoter cannot take more than 5%, and non-promoter cannot take more than 24.99% if you want to indulge money through the equity. Then various eligibility norms are there, various restriction of lock-in and other things are there. And then various legal aspects are also there. ICDR you have to follow, takeover law you have to follow, PIT you have to follow, Companies Act, FEMA Act, taxation and valuation you have to follow. Now, if you see this, that the SEBI has given various relaxation, and we have recently organized a program on right issue, which we have done. Now, SEBI has relaxed four way. Right issue they have relaxed, QIP they have now reduced, because between 2 months to 2 weeks they have done, between the two right issue, two QIP issues. Preferential issue they have threshold changed 5% to 10% they have done, so the promoter can take more share. And then the most interesting, which has come day for yesterday, they introduce relaxed provision of fundraising in stressed companies. Now these are the four things SEBI has suggested, and SEBI has come out various relaxations. Now in this present webinar, we are discussing preferential allotment, and earlier we have discussed detailed right issue. Now preferential allotment is the most preferred route because it's the easiest, fastest, economical, and formalities are minimal. It requires less scrutiny, and choice of investor is with the company. So this is most flexible option with the corporate world. Pricing is also flexible, and investor can be anyone, promoter or outsider. So this is one aspect which is happening, and that's why the fundraising in last 3 years we have seen that preferential issue 17,59,000 crore, 18,92,10,000 crore, 19,21,74,000 crore, and April 20 till date 1,108 crore preferential issues has come. Now if you see the QIP also, in the QIP there is a 53 issue of 67,000 crore, and then 8,678 crore, 18,19, and then 19,20, 54,000 crore rupees the QIP placement has taken place in the companies. And then recently, if we see that various companies has filed their QI, but their preferential allotment, and these are the companies: NK, Dhanra, Mid East, Continental Security, InfoAce, and these companies has given the preferential issue guidelines. Now, if you see this, that preferential issue is 5%, but SEBI has relaxed the 5% to 10%, so promoter can put more money. Because today, what is the need? Need is money. So promoter can put more money, but the restriction they have put in that you cannot buy from the market, you have to put more money because you are saying liquidity problem. Okay. So this is a very attractive, because rate is less and the market and rate is less, and the you can acquire more equity. So that is a win-win situation for the promoter to put money, not to depend on other. Now the second most important thing which has taken place, because insolvency what at their doorstep of various stress company. Now government has given relaxation for 6 months. And then SEBI has come out a very interesting solution, that they are saying now anybody can take any outside promoter, outside the promoter, any percentage, and they have given an exemption of takeover code of 3, 2, and 4, that control change is also allowed. And the most interesting point is rate is also the 2 weeks price, not 60 weeks. If you see last 6 months, if you calculate the price on the 6 month basis, index was 40,000 and today index is 34,000. So if you calculate 6 weeks or 2 weeks and 6 months price, then the price is high. But only taking a 2 months, 2 weeks price is less. So this is a very interesting and attractive proposition for any outside investor who can take. And friends, in my opinion, by doing this 6 months and this insolvency board can extend to 1 year, this is one golden opportunity for various people that they can come out from this insolvency doorstep, and they can bring out more money by their own resource and by the resource of various other investors. And SEBI's relaxation will definitely help them. Now, today we are discussing preferential allotment. And if you see, the preferential allotment is a very small word. But when we see this, and today we are discussing issues, eligibility, prior period, DMAT account, fund availability, loan conversion, SBO, relevant date, frequently, infrequently trading, and then pricing, fixing, pricing, transferability and lock-in shares, sale by one promoter that will disqualify, takeover exemption. And then the other part is, next part is that approvals. You require board approval, board of directors approval, shareholders approval, stock exchange approval. Then you have a governance, pricing, objective of preferential issue. Then you have a process, pre-preferential lock-in, board approval, relevant date, stock exchange, shareholders approval, receipt of in principle approval, offer letter, receipt of fund, board allotment, allotment within 15 days, listing application within 20 days, credit shares, 3 years and 1 year lock-in, and the trading application was 7 days from date of listing or approval. Then you have to compliance of this, Companies Act compliance, SEBI ICDR, takeover, insider, FEMA, and the lenders agreement disclosures. And then the most important is COVID relaxation. So friends, the topic is very small, but contents are very interesting and very complicated. Today we are discussing all these issues, and now I will request Anjali to give his presentation on the entire aspects of preferential allotment, how this ease of fundraising through private placement. Over to Anjali, please.
Bhushan. Hello, bol.
Anjali, start karo. Anjali.
Hello.
Yeah, can you hear me, sir?
Thank you so much, sir, for the enriching introduction to the preferential allotment route. Preferential allotment, as Mr. Pavan Vijay said, that is a very common route and is a very simplified route for fundraising. He also said that during the last fiscal, corporates raised an overwhelming amount of 1,74,000 crores through the preferential allotment route. So that means we can very well imagine how much the corporates rely upon this particular source of fundraising for their listed entities. And there are many, when we say it's a simplified route, it doesn't mean that there are no legal restrictions. We live in a regulated environment when we have to abide by the law of the land. But at the same time, as compared to other modes of allotment, other modes of fundraising, preferential comparatively is on a very lighter side. So, till about 10 days back, till the time that amendment in takeover regulations came on 16th of June, we were talking about rights issues, and actually rights issues were the talk of the corporate world, and we as consultants were also advising all the companies that they should go ahead with rights issues because of the relaxations that have been promulgated by the regulator. But now with the regulation, with the relaxations that have been promulgated in the preferential allotment route, even the preferential allotment route has become all the more lucrative for the corporates to raise their funds. So presently, because of the COVID scenario, the corporate is encircled by a lot many C's in their life. this is COVID crisis, cash crunch. So many problems are there in the organizations. There is a decline in the sales. There is a decline in the internal accruals. Operational expenses by and large remains the same. There are no institutional investors who are willing to invest into the company. There is a question on survival or revival. Survival ka soching, revival ka soching, that again is a big tussle between in the promoter's mind. And of course, there are regulatory limitations. And because the prices have gone all-time low, there always looms a hanging sword that the fear of hostile takeover of the company by any of the competitors. Now, in all these problems, in all the issues that were there in the previous slide, how a preferential issue can help? Preferential issue, as the name suggests, that means we are giving preference to a few people while making the allotment, as compared to a rights issue, wherein we offer the shares to on an equitable basis to all the shareholders. In a preferential allotment, we select a group of people who are interested in investing into the company and thereby increase their stakes in the company, consolidate their holdings in the company, and infuse funds into the company. The allotment is made to those people. Preferential issue, we are again and again saying that it is the fastest and simplest way of raising funds without much regulatory hassles. So what all is a part of preferential issue? As we say, charity begins at home. Likewise, funding also begins at home. In this depressed environment, in this depressed market, if not the promoters, who else will show the confidence to the public shareholders that I have full confidence and full faith in my company, and I know that over a period of time, the company will come out of this negative scenario, and the promoter is all willing to infuse funds into the company. Obviously, when he's infusing funds into the company, he has that intent that, okay, my holdings in the company should also get consolidated. There aren't much regulatory hassles. I'll be taking up the regulatory procedure in the coming slides. There is no restriction on the end use of funds in the sense that as compared to a rights issue, which clearly mandates that at least 75% of the funds raised have to be used for the specified objects for which it has been raised, and not more than 25% can be used for general corporate purposes. In case of a preferential issue, there is no such restriction. Pricing generally happens at or around the market price. And now the SEBI relaxations are also in place, which make the preferential allotment all the more a simplified way. Now, when we talk of preferential route, businesses are money hungry. Jitne paise business ko mil jaye, utne kam hai. So, kis se paise le sakte hain? From who all we can take the money? We can take the money from the promoter and promoter group. We can take the money from non-promoters. We can take the money from the institutional investors, and QIPs are a part of it. And in respect of each of these categories, SEBI has relaxed the norms. SEBI has promulgated various relaxations. Promoters ke liye, there is a separate relaxation. Non-promoters ko agar allotment karna hai, then there is a separate relaxation. And if the allotment is to be made to QIPs, there is a separate relaxation. So SEBI has, obviously when the regulator comes out with any particular relaxation, there is something bigger in its mind that is going on. So what they have in mind right now is to boost this primary market, increase liquidity in the stocks of the company, and to ease the fundraising for the corporate by way of fresh issuance of shares. As I said, for each of the categories, promoters, non-promoters, institutions, there have been relaxations. So these are the booster dose which have been provided by SEBI in the present depressed environment, present COVID pandemic scenario. When the funding is from promoters, the creeping acquisition limit as applicable under the takeover regulations has been increased from 5% in a financial year to 10% in a financial year. My co-panelist Manoj would be taking in detail the provisions of this regulation. Then when it comes to funding from non-promoters and the company is a stressed company, then it's the new circular which has been promulgated only yesterday. It is a ray of hope for such companies to prevent such companies to from going into insolvency and ultimately into liquidation. Regulator has well understood that liquidation is not going to help anybody. If any investor is there who can bail out such companies which are not in a position to meet their debts, to pay off their debts, it's better to infuse, have the funds infused from that investor. And if the if any QIPs are funding is required, is there, can be there in the company. So for that purpose, SEBI has reduced the time gap between any two consecutive QIPs from 6 months to 2 weeks. So in the fund analysis which Pawan sir was giving in his presentation, in the last fiscal there were 14 QIP issuances, approximately 54,000 crores was the amount that was mopped up through the QIP route. But in the current fiscal, in these 3 months, not even a single rupee has been received through the QIP route. So that means there is a dearth of investors. QIB investors are not very keen in investing into the companies as on date. So this also shows that maybe something more is required to be done from the regulator's end to make this funding a more lucrative from the point of view of the QIB investors, QIBs, and also from the point of view of the companies. Now, regulatory scenario. In the coming slides, I'll be taking up the provisions with regard to the SEBI listing regulations. I'm not taking up Companies Act in too much details because most of us being the company secretaries and compliance officers, Companies Act is in our blood. तो हम कंपनी एक्ट को तो हम 42, 62, 71, 55 कोई हमें सोते हुए भी पूछेगा तो हमें पता है कि व्हाट आर द प्रोविजंस, व्हाट डज 42 से. बट सेबी लिस्टिंग रेगुलेशंस वी माइट बी अवेयर ऑफ, बट देन दे आर इम्पोर्टेंट टू अंडरस्टैंड एंड वी नीड टू थरली अबाइड बाय दीज प्रोविजंस बिकॉज देर आर पीनल प्रोविजंस ऑन अ डेली बेसिस, पर डे बेसिस इफ वी डू नॉट कंप्लाई विद एनी ऑफ द प्रोविजंस. The legal framework within which any preferential allotment works is the Companies Act, ICDR regulations, takeover regulations, and the SEBI prohibition of insider trading regulations. All these regulations, all these acts play a very important role. If we will not plan an issue properly, this fundraising exercise may convert into a firm fund mopping exercise for the corporates. In our practical experience, we have seen so many cases wherein the companies were not given proper advice or they decided that, okay, we'll do the preferential allotment on our own. And ultimately, they landed up paying lakhs of settlement fee to the regulator, as a result of which the basic object of fundraising gets somewhere or the other diluted. So what exactly is the process of the preferential allotment and what are the objectives behind a preferential issue? So this is in these few steps, we have tried to explain the process of the life cycle of our entire preferential issue. This generally takes 2 to 3 months from planning, from conceiving the idea of coming out to the preferential allotment till getting the trading approval from the stock exchanges. So first of all, we need to convene a board meeting. For calling this board meeting, we need to give advance intimation to the stock exchanges. Another one important point to be kept in mind by the compliance officers, for board meetings to be held up till 31st of July, we need to give the advance intimation of only 2 days. Otherwise, it is 2 working days. So this again is a good relaxation by the regulator, wherein at a shorter notice, a meeting can be called and the board meeting can be held. Relevant date is the basic date around which the entire focus and entire activity schedule of the preferential allotment revolves. Relevant date is the date with reference to which we have to compute the issue price. Relevant date is the date with reference to which we have to see the lock-in of the holdings of the allottees. And everything else is needed to be taken care of through the relevant date only. Then the pre-preferential holding of the allottees is needed to be put under lock-in. We need to corporate action. We need to institute actions with the NSDL and CDSL. We need to apply to the stock exchanges for their in-principle approval. before applying the in principle approval, one thing we need to keep in mind is we need to get the transaction statements and the DMAT statements, holding statements of all the proposed allottees, and need to check their shareholding in the company during last 6 months. At least there should not have been any sale during last 6 months. We need to take the shareholders' approval. As compared, I somehow keep on comparing a preferential allotment with a rights issue, because only a month back we had a webinar on rights issue as well, and now we are having this preferential allotment webinar. So as compared to a rights issue, there is no requirement of a shareholders approval. Preferential allotment, we require a shareholders approval, and in a way it's good from in the point of view that if any person who's investing into the company, the shareholders feel that the investor, for example, belongs to any of the countries having land borders with India. I'll not name any country, but so any such person should not be a part of our company, should not be investing into the company. They can refuse, they can give their dissent to the said resolution. Then the offer letter, private placement offer letter is needed to be circulated. That is the pass 4. A separate bank account is needed to be opened wherein the monies would be put in. The issue is opened. Once we receive the allotment money, we need to keep in mind that 100% of the consideration is needed to be received, and then only an allotment can be made. And allotment is needed to be made within a specified time frame. I'll be taking it up in the coming slides. Once the allotment is made, we have to make a listing application to the stock exchanges. Herein again, we have to be very careful that the listing application has to be made within a period of 20 days from the date of the allotment. Otherwise, there is a penalty on a per day basis. Once the listing approval is received, the shares are credited in the temporary ISIN number, and then the lock-in on the fresh shares allotted is to be executed. Then the trading application is needed to be filed. Now this trading application again is needed to be filed within 7 working days of the credit of share of the execution of lock-in. Otherwise, herein also there are penal provisions on a daily basis. Once the trading approval has been received, the money can be utilized only upon filing of pass 3 with the ROC. We cannot use the money, the company cannot use the money unless the pass 3 is filed with the ROC. This entire process takes a time frame of 2 to 3 months. So what remains the objective of any preferential allotment to the promoters? Obviously, fund infusion is there. As I said, businesses are money hungry. Whatever we may put in the company, that ultimately proves less. And it is needed on a daily basis to meet the long-term and short-term requirements of the business. And obviously, see, every promoter, every person has this desire that when I'm putting money into the company, my holding should increase. So the second objective behind any further allotment, any preferential allotment, is to increase the stake in the company. This further has two objectives in the promoter's mind. Number one, to increase their own stake in the company. If a promoter is holding only 40% in the company versus a promoter holding 75% in the company, they have a different say in the company. So accordingly, every promoter wants that our stake should be maximized. The third objective can be that if the promoters have given any unsecured loans to the company, so even those can be converted into equity, as a result of which that will improve my company's debt equity ratio and simultaneously serve both the first and second purposes or objectives as well. Now, the key regulatory provisions as per SEBI ICDR regulations. As I told, I'm not going too much into the Companies Act provisions. I'm talking about the SEBI ICDR regulations. The most important being, we need to check the eligibility, whether my company and whether the allottee is eligible to the allotment, to the process. Kaam shuru kar dein, decide karna shuru kar dein, but in the end, we come out that no, the allottee is not eligible, then the entire purpose gets failed. So the most important object is most important need to be checked is that the entire pre-preferential holding of the allottee has to be in DMAT mode. The object is very clear. None of the regulators want any of the any physical transactions to happen, neither ROC nor SEBI. It is a very clear mandate that whatever has to happen in DMAT mode. And then upon promulgation of such conditions, the DMAT stakes in the company would increase. Then no sale or no transfer. Very important condition that during preceding 6 months of the relevant date, the proposed allottee should not have sold any shares in the company during preceding 6 months. Now, this condition is with reference to the allottee, if the allottee is a non-promoter. But if the allotment is being made to the promoter or promoter group, then this restriction is applicable on the entire promoter and promoter group. So if any of the persons belonging to the promoter and promoter group have sold any shares during preceding 6 months, the entire promoter group becomes ineligible for the further allotment. Meaning thereby, if me and my husband are the promoters of a company, I have not sold any shares during preceding 6 months and preferential allotment is proposed to be made to me, but my husband has sold any shares during preceding 6 months. So neither me nor him, both of us become ineligible for any sort of a further allotment, any preferential allotment. Likewise, if we were allotted any warrants in the past, which during last 1 year, which we did not subscribe to or which we had them cancelled, the entire promoter or promoter group becomes ineligible if any such warrants have been unsubscribed or cancelled during last 1 year. And the promoters and directors of the company should not be the fugitive economic offenders. Now, when we talk about this condition that no sale during preceding 6 months, till the promulgation of ICDR 2018, there was a big concern with many companies that if there has been an interstate transfer amongst the promoters, will that tantamount to a sale? To my understanding, it should not have been. And in fact, more so if it's a gift, it should not have been considered a sale by the promoter. But in the informal guidances, there are about 6-7 informal guidances wherein SEBI has said that these will tantamount to sale because the shares are being debited from your DMAT account. Now, this position has been relaxed in the ICDR 2018, which mandates that any interstate transfer amongst the qualifying promoters or promoter group will not be considered a sale. Simultaneously, what they have mandated is transfer of shares on account of invocation of pledge by a scheduled commercial bank, by a public financial institution, or by a systematically important NBFC, or by a mutual fund, or by an insurance company will also not be considered as a sale. So, regarding the second leg of this exemption, we have to be very careful that the invocation of pledge has to be only by these bodies. If I take a loan from a friend's company and I'm not able to pay off the loan and that company invokes the pledge, as a result of which the shares are transferred, debited from my DMAT account, this transaction will not qualify for the relaxation because it is a private party. If any of these agencies are there, there would be proper agreement, there would be proper written documents to prove that yes, it was a genuine loan which was taken and it is a genuine pledge which has been invoked. So these transactions have been exempted. Now, relevant date, as I told you, relevant date is the pivotal point around which the entire gamut of preferential allotments revolve. It is 30 days prior to the date of the shareholders' approval. This is to check the lock-in conditions and as well as the pricing provisions. Now, pricing, again, is a very important criteria. First of all, we have to check whether the shares of the company are frequently traded or infrequently traded. So if the shares are frequently traded is when the trading turnover in the shares of your company is more than 10% of the total number of shares. If the shares are frequently traded, then the average of the higher of the average of high and low of 26 weeks or 2 weeks VWAP, that is volume weighted average price, preceding the relevant date is needed to be considered. And on the other hand, if the shares are infrequently traded, the company has to the valuation is needed to be done on the basis of book value or comparable trading multiples, etc. And a valuation from a registered valuer is required to be obtained. Now herein, there is a particular, because of the present COVID scenario, the way the prices have gone down, the companies can take good advantage of this situation, because for example, we computed the issue price, the preferential issue pricing of a company about a month back, which was coming out to rupees 298. And yesterday when we computed the price, it was coming out to 175. So one can easily understand that obviously by paying in less, I can get more shares. So it is a win-win situation for the company. More funds can be infused into the company, and also for the promoters, by infusing the same amount of funds, the promoters can get more number of shares. Consideration, as I told earlier as well, 100% has to be brought in at the time of allotment. There is no concept of partly paid up shares under the concept or under the private placement route, except in case of warrants, wherein the payment terms can be staggered, at least 25% to be brought in upfront at the time of allotment of warrants, and balance 75% to be brought in before the conversion of those warrants. Otherwise, there is no concept of partly paid up shares. And the allotment is needed to be made within 15 days of the shareholders approval or regulatory approval, whichever is later. So if a transaction is subject to Competition Commission of India's approval, or any SEBI approval, or any RBI approval, the period of 15 days would commence from the receipt of those approvals. If they are received after the shareholders approval, so then this shareholders approval date would be meaningless. The regulatory approval, be it CCI approval or RBI approval or SEBI approval, whichever is later, has to be counted. Pre-pref lock-in is again a very important concept. The entire pre-preferential shareholding of the allottees is needed to be put under lock-in for a period of 6 months from the date of trading approval. Obviously, trading approval date, nobody knows. But then we have to do this calculation on a presumption basis that we have made the allotment on, say, 1st January. Then within 20 days, we have to file the listing application. By 20th, we file the listing application. Listing approval is received, say, within a week's time. By 27th, listing approval is received. And then corporate actions plus trading approval, another 10 days. So that means by 10th of February, probably the trading approval will be received. And accordingly, the shares are needed to be put under lock-in. So this was the condition with regard to the pre-preferential holding. Now the shares which have been allotted under the preferential allotment, they are needed to be put under lock-in for a period of 3 years from the date of allotment, in case the allotment has been made to the promoters, and in case it has been made to the non-promoters, then for a period of 1 year from the date of allotment. Now, takeover regulations. Actually, promoters are apprehensive about this takeover regulations. Why promoters? We as compliance officers as well are really apprehensive of the takeover regulations, are worried on a daily basis. Promoter purchase kar raha hai, ye breach na ho jaye, 2% ka breach ho gaya, to I have to make a disclosure. 5% ka breach ho gaya, to then takeover offer, open offer is triggered. So what relaxation has been pronounced by the regulator under this provision? As we all know that any promoter holding more than 25% of the voting rights or capital can additionally acquire only up to 5% in a financial year without the requirement of triggering of open offer. But SEBI has come out to the rescue of the promoters and the company and has relaxed this 5% to 10% for preferential issue of equity shares to promoters. So that is, as Pawan sir also said in his initial remarks, opening remarks, this is a big relaxation to the company as well as to the promoters, wherein promoters know that they can salvage their companies by infusing funds into the company, and they would not be under an obligation to come out with an open offer. My co-panelist Manoj would be taking in detail the implications of takeover regulations with review of the preferential allotments. So planning a preferential issue, what factors are needed to be considered? So what is my issue price vis-a-vis the running market price? As we have discussed during last 3 months, the prices of the scrips have really gone down. So as a result, when I have to compute the pricing of 26 weeks during the preceding the relevant date, so three months would be this reduced period, and 3 months would be the pre-COVID period, which comparatively the averaging, upon averaging, it gets, the effect gets nullified, and the pricing comparatively, the issue price, the gap between the preferential issue price and the running market price gets shortened. Now, my existing promoter and group holding in the company, if the promoters are already hold, if the promoters have already done a creeping acquisition during these 3 months of 5%, then a preferential issue can be made for the balance 5% in the running financial year, not 10%. In that scenario, 10% would not be applicable. In that scenario, only 5% window will be available to the promoters. And now, and if the promoter and promoter shareholding is less than 25%, say 24.99% or 24% in the company, then this limit should not be breached at any cost. Then it will trigger the open offer. We have to keep in mind this relaxation of 5 to 10% is only with reference to the creeping acquisition. Now, how to choose what route is best, how to balance all the options when we have to decide about a preferential allotment. So fund infusion into the company for meeting the long-term and short-term purposes, if the objective is that, then preferential allotment is the best route available to the company. More shares can be acquired now under the relaxed regime. More shares can be acquired at a given level of funds infused. If still, in spite of having infusing this 10% the capital into the company, still more is required, then the alternative is preferential allotment to non-promoters during the current financial year. Next financial year, of course, further allotment can be planned again. So, but if the object is to increase the promoter's stake, presuming my running market price is less than the issue price, then a scenario, as I discussed earlier, probably the company, the promoters can do 5% market purchase in the current financial year. And for the balance 5%, further allotment of preferential allotment can be planned. As a strategy, maybe warrants issues can also be planned simultaneously, which may be converted in the next financial year. Thereby, 5% equity in the current financial year and 5% warrant conversion in the next financial year can be planned. Now, the third scenario can be where there are unsecured loans issued by, given by the promoters to the company. And the company, because of the cash crunch, because of the COVID scenario, is not in a position to pay off those loans. It is a very desirable situation. It is a very good situation wherein those loans can be converted into equity shares, because that will improve the company's debt equity ratio, that will improve the promoters' holding in the company, and the interest burden which is there on the company's P&L account, that will also get reduced, thereby proving a win-win situation for everybody. So then in that scenario, the 10% holdings, 10% stake can be taken up by the promoters by way of conversion of loan. Now, stress the circular which came up yesterday. Stressed companies. If a company is having a stressed asset, SEBI has very beautifully explained it. SEBI has very beautifully come out with a salvage plan or a survival plan for such companies, wherein first we need to understand the rationale behind it. In the past, we had seen that many a companies were referred to insolvency, and if there were no investors to take to invest into those companies. Those companies even went into liquidation. So liquidation is not helping anybody. Liquidation is rather leading to unemployment. It's rather leading to wastage of the resources, and a lot many other problems are there. So it's better to plan something wherein at the pre-insolvency stage, if something can be curbed or if some corrective action can be taken, why not? So in that scenario, so companies facing the basic rationale behind this circular is listed companies facing financial stress are generally in need of fund infusion because the promoters also do not have money to pump into the company. And if any investor is willing to invest into the company, one should go for it. But at the same time, such companies were facing difficulties in raising capital through the conventional means because preferential issue pricing norms remained 26 weeks or 2 weeks higher. 26 weeks because it was consisting of the time when the company was normal, there was no financial crunch in the company. So the pricing comparatively 26 weeks used to be higher and 2 weeks used to be very, very low. These companies generally face a progressive fall in their market price. So the regulator has decided to do away with the 26-week pricing for these companies and only consider on the 2 weeks pricing. And obviously, for this reason only, there were no investors to come out at to bail out such companies. So what the regulator has mandated, any company, any listed entity would be considered stressed if it has defaulted in payment of interest or repayment of the principal amount to any banks or financial institutions for a period of at least 90 days. SEBI in March, after the lockdown itself, in March, they came out with a discussion paper on the stressed asset funding by the preferential allotment to stressed asset companies. There, wherein it was mandated for 2 quarters. If there is a default for 2 quarters, then the company would be considered a stressed asset company. But in the final circular which has come in, they have mandated only 90 days. That means only 1 quarter would be considered to check whether you are falling within the ambit of a stressed asset or not. There should be an existence of an ICA, inter-creditor agreement, in terms of the RBI norms. And downgrading of credit rating to D of the listed or unlisted instruments. I personally do not agree with credit rating of D because D means the patient is already in coma. Aap usko kitna to oxygen denge, kitna survival uska ho payega. So I personally feel that D should have been at least C, but theek hai, whatever the regulator has mandated. But a very important point which is needed to be kept in mind is these criteria. Number one, any satisfaction of any 2 criteria out of these 3, that company would be considered a stressed company. And these have to be checked at 2 points of time, not at 1 point of time. These have to be checked at 2 points of time. One at the time of dispatch of notice to the shareholders, and then again at the time of allotment. So probably the intent of the regulator is, why, number one, why dispatch of notice to the shareholders? Because this is a new concept which has been brought in, new date which has been brought in the chapter 5 of the ICDR regulation. Probably the intent of the regulator is that the company should go out of the hands of the existing promoters to a new promoter, or a new promoter should invest to such a huge extent as late as possible. So if relevant date karenge, to relevant date or the date of board meeting karenge, to they would happen comparatively much before. Dispatch of notice generally happens at least after 10 days of the board meeting. So aap 10 days tak apne apna decision postpone kar liya. If the promoters have the capacity, have the capability of paying off the loans or making good the default, they should do it and retain their company's controls. And again, at the time of allotment, probably if, again, this is just my analysis, that if during the dispatch of notice and the time of allotment, by chance, if any of the contingent payments which was to be received is received by the company, say all of a sudden 20 crores is received, 200 crores is received, and the company is in a position to pay off the bank loans, then there is no need to make the allotment to that allottee, and one can retain the control of the company to itself. These two conditions are needed to be certified by the statutory auditor and also the audit committee. The relaxations that have been granted are, as I told you, 26 weeks has been done away with in this situation. Average of the weekly high and low of VWAP of 2 weeks preceding the relevant date is needed to be seen. And simultaneously, a very big relaxation which has been announced is exemption from open offer. Even if the holding of the investor crosses 25% threshold, it is exempt from the provisions of Regulation 3.1 and Regulation 4. Manoj would again be taking this up in detail. Conditions precedent. There are certain conditions precedent. The allottee should be a non-promoter, number one. The special resolution is to be passed by majority of minority. Then the funds cannot be used for repayment of loans towards the promoters. Monitoring agency is needed to be appointed, and 3-year lock-in is required to be. 3-year lock-in from the trading approval is required. Now, Manoj would be taking up over to Manoj for discussing the takeover implications for the preferential in the preferential issues. Manoj, over to you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, ma'am, for detailing the things with respect to the whole process of preferential allotment and the relaxation given by the SEBI. Now, in case whenever a company start planning preferential allotment to promoter or any other person, one of the most critical SEBI regulation is the takeover regulation, SEBI takeover regulation, which is also called the SEBI SAST regulation. Because it is so important because it has several thresholds, and if something is missed out, then there can be a trigger of open offer, which will be a very costly process, costly and time consuming process. So considering that, any preferential allotment need to be very carefully planned so that there is no trigger of open offer obligation, and as well as whenever there is allotment, whatever the disclosure requirements are, they are in takeover regulation are duly met. So if we start with the key implications of takeover regulation on in case of preferential allotment, we have to understand there are two basic thresholds in case of any company, any listed company. First one is the 25%. First is the initial threshold, which is the 25% of the voting shares of any company. So if someone who is below 25% breaches this limit, then there is a requirement to give takeover open offer. So generally, promoters are beyond this 25% limit collectively. But this limit is not only collective, but as an individual also. So let's say there are the total promoter holding is let's say 55%, but one of the promoter is holding only for 24% or 23%, and a preferential allotment is planned. By chance, this person who is at 23%, which is the 25% limit, then there will be a requirement of takeover open offer. So it has to be planned in a way that this person does not reach the limit of 25%, and any other promoter is given shares if it is required. Then the second limit is the creeping acquisition limit of 5%. This 5% is the annual financial year based limit, and any person is always means acquirer along with the person acting in concert with him, if they are between 25% and 75%, and they want to acquire additional shares, whether by way of preferential allotment or by way of market purchase or any other mode, their holding should not reach the limit of 5% in that financial year. So this is the second limit, and as Anjali ma'am was telling, this limit has been relaxed for preferential allotment during this financial year to 10%. The third, and this we have to be very careful that both the limits are seen on the basis of collectively an entire promoter group, or if it is not a part of the promoter group, then promoter and the person acquirer and person acting in concert with him. So it has to be seen collectively as well as individually. Next. So what changes has been made? Basically, briefly, Anjali ma'am has already told, for considering that there is a huge market price fall and the company need money, which can be provided by the promoters in this crucial time of COVID. SEBI has 2 days back relaxed the provisions with respect to the takeover regulation, applicability of takeover open offer obligation in case of preferential allotment to promoters. So if a promoter is holding more than 25% but less than 75% and they want to acquire additional share in by way of preferential allotment, then the creeping acquisition limit of 5% will be replaced by 10%. But this relaxation is applicable only for this financial year, and it is the collective threshold of creeping limit. So if some person has already acquired, let's say 3% or 2% shares during this financial year since 1st April till this date, then that will also be reduced from the 10% creeping acquisition limit. So if someone has, if the promoter group has already acquired 3%, they can only acquire 7% more through preference allotment. Or they may plan 2% further acquisition from the market and 5% additional from the preferential allotment rule. So what are the conditions for this relaxation? This relaxation is only with respect to creeping acquisition. We have to be very careful that it is not giving the initial threshold related exemption. So let's say if the promoter group is not beyond 25% or one of the promoters is not beyond 25% in a company, then that person cannot go beyond 25% due to this relaxation. It will be only to the persons who are between 25% and 75%. Then this relaxation is only with respect to preference allotment, because the SEBI wants infusion of fund into the company. It cannot be by way of market purchase. Then this relaxation is available to the promoter and promoter group of the company. It cannot be by any third party, whether or not he is beyond 25%. And this relaxation is available only up to 31st March 2021. After that, whether they will relax further or not, nobody knows, but presently it's for this financial year only. So why this was necessary? As briefly, Anjali ma'am has already told that promoter are the first person who can infuse fund into a company when there is a stress. And at this moment, when the prices are falling and the business scenario is bleak, nobody wants to put money into the company. So promoter is coming to rescue the company. And because promoters are coming to rescue the company, then and the company need more fund, which cannot be given by the promoter because of the restriction of 5%. Now this limit is 10%, so additional funds can be infused by the by the promoters into the company, and they will not be required to give open offer. Then additional second exemption which came yesterday only is with respect to the exemption in case of a stress company is defined, and the ma'am has already discussed. These are three out of two conditions. If they are getting fulfilled, then this company will be treated as a stress company, and a stress listed company can allot any share to any person who is not part of the promoter group not controlled by the promoter and promoter group, and that person can directly become the co-promoter or sole promoter of the company. So the regulation 4 of the takeover regulation, which is with respect to the change in control, single to joint or directly change in control, will be exempted. Second exemption is the initial threshold. So here, if someone is coming to bail out a stress company, he will not be required to give open offer if he breached the 25% limit, acquisition limit. So second conditions, eligibility criteria is also there for the acquirer. So acquirer has to be a person who is not part of the promoter group. He should not be debarred from the capital market, not a economic offender, not a willful defaulter. And if these conditions are getting fulfilled, then this person, whether an individual or a body corporate, can be used as a investor bailout person. This provision is very much similar to the old day scenario of SICA, when the SIC Industrial Companies Act, under which investors were brought in by companies to bail out a SIC company. and there was no requirement of takeover open offer, and the preferential allotment law was also relaxed for them. So similar type of relaxation has been brought back for stress companies. One very important part is how to calculate the creeping acquisition limit when we are doing the preferential allotment. So we have to be very careful. This acquisition has to be in the on the gross basis, and we have to ignore intermittent fall in the shareholding. Let's say in if a promoter group has acquired certain shares and then sold certain shares, and then again given shares under preferential allotment, the sale will not be counted. But in case of preferential allotment, this scenario may not be there, because there is a restriction. If any of the promoter has sold any share, then the whole entire promoter group becomes ineligible to acquire. Another situation may be due to preferential allotment to any third party or investors. If the capital base has changed and the percentage holding of the promoter has fallen, that fall will not be counted towards either relaxation in this creeping acquisition limit of 5% or 10% as the case may be. And so each addition of the shares, percentage share, has to be taken into account. And if the limit is overall limit should not be breached with overall limit in case of promoter and through preferential allotment and through market purchase collectively should not be more than 10%. Market purchase should not be 5% in any case. And nobody should breach the limit of the threshold of 25% or 5% as the case may be. In case there is a change in capital base, then the pre-preferential allotment percentage holding and post-allotment percentage holding is considered as a to determine the change and increase or increase in holding of the person. To discuss this creeping acquisition limit and how it is calculated, so I have given a few examples. Let's say a promoter acquirer is holding 30%. In our company, and he acquires 2% further shares from the market, then there is a dilution of the shareholding of the person due to preferential allotment or increase in capital by 1%. So increase, and then pursuant to preferential allotment, he acquires 4% shares. So whether it will trigger open offer obligation under 3.2 of the takeover regulation? Yes, answer is yes, because the 1% downfall in the percentage holding will not be counted towards the threshold limit. Here I have taken the example of any other financial year, and for this financial year preferential allotment is being done, so the limit of 4% will not be there, it will be 10% overall. One more example I have taken, let's say pre-preferential allotment holding is 30%, and then preferential allotment of 10 happens. So the post percentage holding is 40. So it is 6.36, total acquisition is 6%, which will 6.36%. So it will trigger open offer obligation under 3.2. Generally, it seems that it is not total, overall holding is not.
Manoj, your voice is not the voice. Manoj, your voice is not. Hello. So I think so by this I think Manoj's voice is not coming. So I'm just coming.
Hello.
Yeah, Manoj,
hello.
Your voice.
Yeah, Manoj. Yeah.
Is it now audible? Hello.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, so I was telling in here we have to calculate on the basis of the expanded capital base, and the total percentage increase is 6.36% here. So whether 3.2 is triggered for this financial year, it will not trigger for takeover obligation, but for all other financial year, it will trigger. Next slide, please. One question, one pertinent question is whether promoter and promoter group can breach the 75% limit in a company. So the answer is no. There is this exemption under takeover regulation. This limit of 75% can be breached only in a scenario when the promoter is triggering open offer obligation, or any person is triggering open offer obligation, and due to the tender by the public shareholder, the holding goes beyond 75%. then this provision is allowed, this acquisition is allowed in the interest of the public shareholders. But there is a condition that the promoter or the acquirer must come back to 75% within 1 year as per the SEBI prescribed form one of the six methods or any of the six methods to dilute the holding. So they cannot remain beyond 75% for more than 1 year. So if let's say if a person goes beyond 25% in a present scenario, if he is let's say 24% and want to acquire the share, then there will be an open offer obligation on the person, and that open offer obligation will be based on the 60 days volume weighted average price. So presently the prices are low, so this may also be a strategy. Similarly, 10% through preferential allotment is not allowed. So if a person goes beyond 10%, want to take more shares in the company, then again it will be a trigger or open offer trigger for the promoters also, and that will be the same basis. So these two are mandatory open offers. So the offer will be for at least 26% of additional shares to be bought from the market public shareholders. With respect to takeover regulation, there is another thing we have to keep in mind, that there are disclosure requirements. So there are two thresholds. A person who is holding 5% or less shares, if they breach the limit of 5%, they have to give first initial disclosure. And if a person is holding more than 5% and they want to acquire additional share, 2% additional share, they have to give disclosure under 29(2) of the takeover regulations. I think broadly these are the takeover related provisions applicable to preferential allotment or issue of capital. And more things may be discussed by Mr. Joshi, who is the regulator and doing giving all kind of approvals. So he will be in a better position to discuss. Thank you all. Over to Mr. Joshi.
Joshi ji, ab aap apna your entire presentation. Joshi, your voice is not coming. Joshi, your voice. Joshi, आपकी voice नहीं आ रही है.
Sir, you are muted.
योशी जी, आपकी वॉइस नहीं आ रही है.
हाँ, now you can hear me?
Yes, sir.
Now we can.
So good evening, everybody. Thank you, corporate professional team and Mr. Pawan ji, giving opportunity to BAC to share its views on what are the things going by the exchange at the back end when we try to process the preferential issue applications of various companies, and what are the normal things we observe, and what are the things we actually expect company to know, avoid those minimum mistakes, and some aspects of governance which we try to see the qualitative aspects. Now, after everything is explained in detail by Anjali and even also Manoj, so we are not going to the process, but I think one point Anjali has shared on the disclosures in the notice. Because when you announce intimation of preferential issues, and when you come out with a notice to your shareholder, so notice to the shareholder is very important when you want to make allotment to the say promoter as well as non-promoter, because promoters are the main person who are bringing money. So if they are beneficial in owner, that has to be disclosed very thoroughly. Sometimes in case the promoter is a corporate entity, maybe private limited company, and again under the private limited company, individual promoter or family members also a shareholder. So if any entity to which you are making allotment, and if it is a particularly if it is not a promoter, okay, in that entity you not shown as non-promoter, and under that if you open the layer and no, it's a private limited company or limited company, again they are making allotment to one private limited company. And under the private limited company, if any person is turns out to be promoter, then it's a disaster. It will kill the proposal at per se, because Now it is, though you're shown as a non-promoter, it is turned out to be a promoter. So that disclosure has to be there. Even if you say I will correct it, but that correction is not allowed, then you have to go with the fresh approval of the shareholder. So that is very important when the beneficial owner, when you want to show that entity to which you are making allotment are actually corporate entity or any fund or any registered fund, whether in India or outside India, so who are the ultimate beneficial owner. That detail has to be given very thoroughly in your notice, which is very important for us. Another important thing which we have observed that people make the mistake of disclosing prior holding and post holding. Because if you see the eligibility condition, which has been discussed earlier also, that willful defaulter, fugitive, another important condition is 75-25. Promoter holding should not go above 75%. And at the same time, we are talking about this acquisition, how much whether it is holding is going by 5%, 10%. So if the pre and post holding of the promoter, this person who are getting the shares, that is to disclose very thoroughly in the notice to the shareholder. There shouldn't be any error. Even if error is obvious error, and even if you can say it's a grammar, it's a computation error. But if the error has happened in respect to showing holding of promoter, then your proposal is gone, it's killed, because then normally there is a SEBI says any disclosure which is respect disclosed for promoter, if any mistakes are there, even if there are any omissions, it is not acceptable and company has to go with the fresh resolution. If it is a non-promoter, then there are ways people go for the ratifications. And now suppose it is, you're filed immediately after the shareholder's approval and with the exchange and general body meeting yet to happen, then you can come out with a corrigendum, some newspaper announcement, informing to all shareholders that with this disclosure, this should be read like this. But that is allowed only if it is non-promoter. If it is promoter, then it is as good as not acceptable, and company has to go with the fresh process again. This is one thing which we want people to be very careful. Another is dealing. Of course, dealing has been discussed clearly by Anjali also. There shouldn't be dealing by the promoter and other persons prior to during their eligibility period. So there shouldn't be dealing in the share. At times, company is not aware that the person to whom they are making allotment, that person has actually given disclosure of all his demat account. The person is actually eligible to invest into the shares. Sometimes such persons are being debarred by SEBI. So you have to clearly go to the, of course, when promoter is bringing some outsider, we know he or she has done the due diligence of that person. And sometimes that person may not be the investor. He or she will bring another third person. No, this person is not going to invest, but this person will invest and he is my or person. Then you have to be very careful when such persons comes, you have to get his PAN detail and all this detail. And some of these details are also available on the stock exchange website. You have to see whether such persons are actually eligible to come access the capital market, they're allowed to invest in the stock market. This is mainly when a person, third person is coming. This is very important. At times, when there are many companies which have so many promoters, some are related, some very big group. And sometimes SEBI has debarred some kind of entity because that person may be promoter or independent director in another company, and that company has not done those compliance, and those persons demat account has been frozen. So you have to be very careful when you take the promoter's demat account or his or his relative, whether nothing has any embargo has come on such person. Otherwise it creates problem at the time of when you make the allotment, because they cannot subscribe to the shares. Another is we have observed sometimes the requirements say you have to give statutory auditor certificate in the general body meeting. At times companies forget or at least they are not able to demonstrate to the stock exchange that this auditor certificate was placed in the AGM to show to the shareholder and it has been already taken note. So this, some companies miss out this aspect, so that we want to bring to notice that this is also important. Another is a non-cash consideration. So that has been also explained that even you can convert the loan. But sometimes, we go with the book entry, but how the origin of the loan, actually the loan, there was actual infusion of the fund by the promoter in the company, or it was just another, like the promoter has brought the assets and the assets has been shown as the loan. So of course we don't try to discourage, but we do check those transactions thoroughly when it is a non-cash consideration, because that's, we want to see the genesis of such loan transactions, whether loan was just created before the professional issue or it was actual genuine loan and the money was being used in the company priorly. So prior period, that is very important. Pricing error at times happens. Sometimes company makes some small mistake in the pricing. This we have observed mainly in case of restructuring cases. Sometimes whenever restructuring case is happening and every lender, they follow them different formula and they try to fit their existing loan in a convert into share. So they work out some different method of price. And of course, it's more or less near to the formula of 26 week and 2 weeks formula, but at times there is a mistake up to second and third decimal also. Then it creates problem. It also requires ratifications again from the shareholder, and company is again being told to do those formalities. Fourth point, which is not so relevant for this, but at times we have observed that promoter has done some previous preferential issue and that has become sub judice or it is under some consideration and stock exchange has not approved those preferential issues because of non-compliance, some other issues, and waiting that the promoters again plan another preferential issues. So if any previous preferential issue is not approved or yet to be approved, then you should not plan, because we go with the FIFO method. Unless until the previous one is cleared, we will not allow the clearance of the second one. So you have to be very clear, if nothing is sub judice prior preferential issues allotment. So these are the things which we thought, which are mainly errors which are being observed, and company has to be very careful when they plan the preferential issue. As far as governance is concerned, we don't go into the governance aspect, that whoever is bringing, what is the other rules of the government or the company has appointed woman director or LODR compliance per se, because there is a separate penalty also for that. But as say, like 75-25 rule is very important. And another important rule is the bank account. At times, you have to see the money is coming from the person allotment, because as far as anti-money laundering concerned, only the money has to come from the promoter account or the investor account whom allotment has happened. But at times, may not be for applicable to all company, but some companies, stock exchange takes regular action against those companies. They do price manipulation, they are in ASM, GSM, and when such companies come out with the preferential issues, then they will be under different radar. We have our own quality checks, why this promoter is doing preferential issue when it was in ASM, GSM, it has gone through so much price band. So those companies will be scrutinized further in terms of actually what is the intention of doing this preferential issues. Okay, this is very important, because then we'll examine those deal with the finer, more detailed lens. Third was the Pavanji has told me that you share those cases where we have also often rejected, or some cases sometimes being referred to the SEBI, main regulator, because stock exchange is not have full power to approve any of the ICDR non-compliance, and we can give. So we have to refer matter to SEBI. Even before referring matter to SEBI, if it is often not compliant, we tell company to we reject the application, company to file the revised application. Like, this promoter is not eligible, or the dealing has happened in the last six prior period. So on those cases, we do, even beneficial interest means even not a total disclosure has happened of the ultimate beneficial owner. Even there is no scope that we interpret, it can be considered. In such cases, we often reject and tell company to you make the revised application. But sometimes what happens, company, it has been observed, some company missed the deadline, 15 days, 20 days, and those cases, or even companies sometimes, some companies we observe, they fail to take prior approval. In principle, approval is very important activity. Of course, rest of the provision they have complied, but sometimes they forget it, or they are not even pricing, everything is being complied, but they have not done this formality. So if the company has not taken in principle approval, we don't reject the application. We have referred to SEBI in the past, and SEBI has also approved on case to case basis if a company is provided it has complied with all other provisions. Just they have not met the formality of taking prior approval, in principle approval. Another case is where SEBI also approves on case to case basis, like if company has failed to come to the stock exchange within 15 days for making in principle approval, or after allotment has happened to make application to stock exchange within 20 days. Sometimes company makes those omission. Then again, we refer to the SEBI, and SEBI has considered some case, genuine cases that they have not said no. But again, some companies still insist, even I omitted to disclose the ultimate beneficiary owner. This is a small error. Why don't you refer to SEBI? And we know it will not likely to be approved by SEBI. But when company insists, then we refer to SEBI. And SEBI has, in most cases, all cases, they have rejected such cases, because this is very important in terms of governance. Because see, ultimately, who is going to put money? Though we are discussing this seminar in the context of COVID, and it's a good opportunity for promoter to increase their holding or put liquidity into the company at a lower price. This is fair enough, but at the same time, it cannot be misused by the people. So who are the ultimate beneficiary owner? Actually, promoter is not hiding the information, and indirectly they are acquiring shares through some another entity, and those things should not be compromised. Other, it will be in all violation of other takeover code and other regulations. So these things are very important. And even such cases when we have referred in the past to SEBI, we know it will be rejected by the SEBI, but company insists, and we don't want to annoy our customer. So if they insist, we refer to such cases to SEBI. We also tell company to make application, and SEBI has rejected such cases, because these are the question of governance, and SEBI will not give any compromise on this basis. Process aspect, at times approval has been given, as I discussed, 15 days, 20 days, those lapses are considered. Okay, so I think I will close my talk on this, and we can take few questions and answers. Thank you, Pavanji.
Okay, thank you, Girish ji. Thank you very much for giving insight of this. Now I have received more than 50 questions, so I'll try to, these are some of the questions Anjali and Manoj and Girish ji has given answer, but even then, so my request to all three panelists, please be brief, give the answer, and then accordingly I will move. So now first question is restructuring. Manoj, can a listed company having 60 lakh as a paid up capital go for preferential allotment up to 10 crore?
Yes, legally there is no requirement, no restriction. Only thing is percentage holding, what percentage, who will get, that has to be taken care of. If there are, let's say, 10-20 investors who are coming and collectively they are putting 100 crore, none of them will hold less than more than 10%, then it's fine, no problem. Our promoter may, let's say, our promoter is holding 50%, they may subscribe to 5 crore, and balance 5 crore is divided into 5 or 6 persons, then it is also possible. So there is legally no hurdle.
Okay. Next is...
Preference allotments done to the QIB investor, there shouldn't be any problem. If it is QIB investor, to whom it actually, not 10 crore, who is putting, that is very important.
Right.
Whether actually QIB, yeah. Okay. Now we can take second question. Yes.
Anjali, in case of loss-making company, if the market price is less than the face value, that can be issued preference allotment to a market price which is less than the face value?
No. The minimum price has to be the face value.
Okay. Next is right issue, FMR. Manoj, the management of companies proposing to raise capital by a right issue. It is a right issue question, but somebody has asked, is it connected to China? So it may be right issue or preferential issue which money is coming from China. So when application has to be approved by FIPB, within the offer period or after the allotment of shares?
It will, in case of right issue, it has to be pre-approval, approved. We cannot issue the offer. Prior approval is mandatory.
Okay. Next is, takeover, whether the buffer of 10% as provided for under a SEBI relaxation can be utilized by way of market acquisition of 5% share and 5% by way of preferential allotment. It is applicable?
Yes. Practically, yes, if the promoter have already acquired or may want to keep the creeping acquisition limit of 5% for the market and 5% additionally through preferential allotment, it is legally valid, it is valid, and it can be done during this financial year only.
Okay. Next is Girish ji. Is it possible to receive the application money in tranches, or the amount is entirely required to be received at the time of application itself? So the question is, tranches mein can we take money?
No, no, miss, because partly paid preferential share has to be fully paid. So now issue is open. So means of course company can take money in the, but in the bank account, which under section 42 you are monitoring, in dedicated bank account you are opening, there investor can put money into different tranche, but it should at least match with their application amount. That is my view. What is Anjali's, your view?
I agree with what Mr. Joshi is saying, or the company can plan a warrants issue wherein 25% can be brought in upfront and 75% at the time of conversion within 18 months.
Okay. Next question is, Manoj, this is a creeping acquisition. The promoter bought 0% share during the year already from the market. So their promoter can purchase 9.97% from preferential allotment, or whether the promoter group become ineligible to for the 10% limit.
Yeah, calculation, I think a bit there is a mistake, 9.7% which is available. Yes, so that can be used, as we have discussed in the first question also, if second question, that 10% is the collective limit for this financial year, which is for, out of which the first 5% is open for all the methods, and the balance 5% is only for the preferential allotment to promoters. So let's say if the promoter is already acquired 0.3%, they can acquire 9.7% in the form of preferential allotment. There is no restriction on that.
Okay. Next is actually whether the transmission of shareholder regulation 31A of LODR would be considered as sale.
To my opinion, no. But I think Mr. Joshi will be able to tell this better from a regulatory perspective.
Joshi ji, what is your view?
Transmission
there is no consideration. No, when you sell, there is a two-way party. You get it considered. Transmission is happening by different process of law. So it is not a sale.
Yeah.
So there is no money is not received by the promoter. Okay. So you can't say it is a sale.
Okay. Next is warrant fund utilization. So in case of warrant, there will not be any filing of PAS3. So can we use a 25% fund receipt or wait till they convert the warrant and file PS3? Anjali.
There is no, the PAS3 has not been created from the perspective of warrants, because warrants per se are not been recognized in the Companies Act. But otherwise, for warrants, we can use the 25% upfront that we have received upon allotment of warrants.
As per sir, in addition, I would like to add that issue of shares by a listed company is in the domain of SEBI, and SEBI has recognized a warrant as a specified security for the for a specific purpose, and hence the issue of warrant is fully in compliance, and the money can be utilized. Otherwise, there is no purpose of taking money in tranches if it has to remain in the bank.
Okay, Girish ji, somebody is asking what is the difference between placement and preferential allotment.
See, this is more a theoretical and philosophical question. Placement, when it is not a listed company, it can be treated as a private placement. When it's a listed company, you can't do private placement. Private placement is allowed only through way of preferential allotment under the ICDR regulations. Otherwise, before the listing, whatever shares you place with anyone, as long as you do under the Companies Act compliance, there is no problem. That kind of private placement is allowed. Of course, section 42 is very important. You have to comply with section 42. But if you want to do for a listed company, then it is a hybrid of private placement plus SEBI regulation requirement, stock exchange requirement, or preferential allotment, what we have in this entire session.
Okay. Next is Manoj, warrant. Please explain the payment term in terms of issuance of warrant.
Payment, the law requires that at least 25% should come upfront at the time of allotment of warrants in case of listed company, and the balance 75% must come within 18 months because that is the maximum tenure for any convertible instrument in case of listed companies private preferential allotment. So if that is not coming, then the money which has brought in as a front money will be forfeited. That is the law.
Okay, Anjali, conversion of loan. What is the procedure to conversion of promoter's loan into equity? Because that is a question everyone is asking.
There is no specific provision for conversion of loan into equity. In the explanatory statement, the company has to mention in the explicit terms that it is a conversion of loan into equity and no fresh funds would be coming into the company.
Conversion loan into equity, because it, as long as there is, I don't think section 42 applies of Companies Act, because money is not coming, but company passed the resolution, actually money should, loan has come in the form of cash or otherwise cash, which is shown in the books of accounts. That's all. And as long as the resolution is passed by the board of directors and also approved by the shareholder, because very important, it's also approved by the shareholder. So there is no problem in going ahead, because it is done in a more transparent way.
Rishi, will you not check the money which has come originally, or this is book entry?
So that, of course, that is we check. We do check the money has to, because we have to see the how long the loan is there in the books of account. It is not just created not to prior to the board meeting where you decide I want to. So it should not be like a book entry. It should be the genuine money has come and it was being deployed in the company, and some assets or something has been created that way, or maybe to meet some cash losses.
And money should have actually come from the respective allottee's account only. That is again a requirement to which exchanges look into. If the money is from somebody else's account and the allotment is being made to some other person, exchanges do have restrictions in that.
Okay. Now, second is whether creation of pledge be considered be transfer if pledge has been made by the promoter in favor of bank, is he eligible for preferential allotment? Anjali?
Creation of pledge is not considered a transfer because the shares remain in your account, in your DMAT account. If the pledge is invoked, that would be considered, may be considered as transfer. If it is not a scheduled commercial bank or a public financial institution or a mutual fund, and such a person is eligible for a preferential allotment.
Okay, Manoj, a promoter individual holds 22% shares. Presently, how much shares he can acquire without triggering open offer obligation? Is there any exemption available for acquiring more than 25% without making open offer?
So, as I discussed in my initial presentation, the initial threshold of 25% is intact and there is no relaxation for the same. So, if the person is already holding 22% shares, they cannot breach the 25% limit. And if the limit breached, then there will be open offer obligation. Whether this is with respect to individual persons as well as in case there is a person acting in concert or collectively. Both way we have to check.
Okay. Next is, can normal companies take benefit of acquiring shares through preferential route under regulations 164A of ICDR, which is for stress asset companies? Is understanding correct? Please clarify, Anjali or Grishi, anybody.
Only the stressed asset companies can avail this benefit. Normal companies will have to follow 164 itself, the normal pricing provisions.
Do you have any different view?
No,
I think.
Okay. Next, ICDR eligibility. Please clarify, one of the promoter has been reclassified to public category in last 6 months. Do we have checks sale by him as well as determine promoter's group eligibility? Anjali, Grishji, both, because this is very complicated.
Once the promoter has been classified as a public category through the approved process, because that also being done by stock exchange process under SEBI defined regulation, the person is no longer a promoter. So even if sale is done by him on the time of making this, he is not a promoter. So it should not have any problem.
Okay. Now the rapid round starting. Okay, so you have to give very fast answer and only one person will give one answer. pre-lock-in, conversion of loan into equity, or conversion of loan into equity of any promoter, whether pre-preferential allotment will be locked in for 6 months? Anjali?
I didn't get the question.
For conversion of loan into equity of any promoter, whether pre-preferential allotment will be locked
in? It will be checked. It will be locked in.
Okay.
Yes.
Girishji, can a suspended company come out with preferential allotment of shares warrant?
No, because there is no price discovery. If suspended companies, there is no trading, how will work out the rule of 26 week and 2 weeks rule? That is not allowed. So it has to have price discovery.
Okay. Manoj, whether 25% limit is to be checked on individual basis or PSC?
Both collectively as well as individually.
Okay, Anjali, whether we need to consider 2 weeks price or 26 weeks price for preferential issue?
Yeah.
Okay.
26 weeks pricing is required.
Okay, Girishji, if the company has completed buyback 5 months back and the promoter have not tendered any share in the same, can the company do preferential allotment to promoters?
Promoter has not tendered. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Because there is no transactions. I think Anjali.
Yeah. As per the recent amendment in the buyback regulations, the no further allotment period of 1 year earlier has been reduced to 6 months. So after the 6 months period is over, 6 months window is over, the further allotment can be planned.
Okay. Vivek, just remove this this screen because Manoj. Exemption from takeover. This is a listed company whose account is NPA and OTS proposed underway. The promoter of the company holds 58%. Now 3% joint intent to purchase the shareholding stake of promoter at a price equivalent to OTS amount to be approved by lenders. Whether exemption available for open offer? If not, when the open offer obligation would be triggered at the time of MOU, or when the OTS finally approved and date when full payment towards OTS is made? Question is big.
Yeah, question is not big, but the stress company provisions, there are two. If the conditions are getting fulfilled of the under new stress company conditions, then the benefit can be taken and offer will not trigger. But otherwise, it is a private transaction when banks, promoters as well as management and some banks enter into some OTS arrangement and some investors come. So there will be offer of obligation and offer will trigger whenever there is a concrete agreement, understanding. So I think OTS is the precondition. Without that, they will not put the money, so they will not get the shares. Nothing will happen. So that's what
Now, Girishji, can promoter acquire more than 75% light of MPS relaxation granted by SEBI?
No, to preferential issue, strictly no. It is not allowed. If you go through preferential issue, it's only allowed in some cases through the scheme. Then SEBI gives some time for dilution, but that is also now it has been discontinued.
Okay.
So 75.
Okay, got it. Manoj, does the relaxation for stressed asset in preferential allotment duly taken into account of provision of regarding 29 of IBC, or does it negate overriding the provision of regulation 29? The credit rating has also been cancelled.
Hello.
Yeah, Manoj, just speak.
Yes, sir.
We can hear you.
It was not very well. Okay, so IBC 29A is with respect to eligibility criteria of a person who can be a resolution applicant under insolvency law, but that is not applicable in case of stress assets or in a company which is under joint lenders forum as per the RBI circular dated 7th June 2019. So at that time, promoters are also eligible even in case it is a NPA, company's NPA. So it is not coming under as a hurdle.
Okay, Anjali, what percentage of shares vote is needed? Does voting by promoter count if part of the preferential allotment is made to promoter?
Yeah, promoters are allowed to vote.
Okay. Girishji, for conversion of loan, prior approval of shareholder is necessary before issuing raising of loan? I think this question
Because when you did the loan, there is no intention that you cannot into equity, no?
That's right, it's something. Okay. Now,
it may be related party transaction.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, warrant. Yeah, come on.
What will happen if share price has fallen significantly post allotment of warrant price? Can investor forego warrants?
Yeah, the investor can forego. But the 25% money infused upfront will be forfeited by the company.
Or if the
person. And secondly, the promoter group will become ineligible for a period of 1 year to infuse to further allotments.
Okay, and then if I'm an outsider, then?
Then. Forfeiture will be there, but this condition is second condition is not there.
So I as a non-promoter, I can be allotted other shares. I can forfeit. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. What about conversion of employee due into equity? Can this be achieved through preferential offer? Girish ji.
Hello. Sorry, I could not hear.
What about conversion of employee dues into equity? Suppose the BSC has to pay some amount to you as a employee dues. And then they can convert to equity.
No, there is no such currently provision.
Can be considered as debt, and it can if the employee is agreeing and he is then his part of the
and shareholder approval should come. And shareholder approval should also come, no?
Yes.
Okay. All the conditions. Yeah.
Okay. What about conversion of employee due? What will happen if the share? This is okay. The conversion. Acha, promoter reclassification. No, I think this is a different question. This Manoj, our company has to make preferential allotment to corporate creditor pursuant to resolution plan under IBC. Do we require to comply with ICDR regulation since compliance under Companies Act is exempt?
No. It is also exempt under ICDR regulation.
Okay. Lock-in provisions and pricing provisions are to be checked, nothing else.
Okay. One question, Anjali and Girish ji. Suppose I am not eligible, there is some eligibility norm, and one of the eligibility norm I am not able to fulfill. Some of the promoter has sold, say, 100 shares by mistake in last 6 months. Can I go for exemption in SEBI, Girish ji?
Even if you go, I doubt SEBI will approve it because this is very, very, very strict condition in terms of governance. So, question of going to SEBI, so we don't tell company there is no point going to SEBI. You will get straight away no, but there is no time. We can't annoy our customer. Let them go.
Okay. Manoj, our company has paid stamp duty on preferential issue of convertible security. Does it again has to pay stamp duty on equity share arising of the time of conversion?
No, stamp Indian Stamp Act has specific provision of remission of liability and remission of duty in case same instrument is being converted into another class of instrument, then second duty need not be paid.
Okay, Manoj, there is a question on taxation. In case of issue price is less than the market price of acquisition, what will be the tax implication at the time of acquisition? Also, in case of such shares are sold, what will be the capital gain?
If the ICDR regulation, you are meeting the conditions of ICDR pricing norm, SEBI pricing norm, then there is no tax implication. It will be tax neutral transaction at the time of acquisition allotment. And then second leg, yes, it will be there will be capital gain from the issue price to the sale price. It depends upon whether it is an on market transaction and off market transaction. If it happens as on market transaction after 1 year, then it will be under a special rate of 10%. If it is off market transaction, then it is a 15%. For short term, it will be 15% in a flat.
Somebody has asked us, SEBI must seriously consider getting clearance from investigation agency before granting preferential issue approved to such a stress listed company. Somebody has given this suggestion.
No.
Okay. SEBI has specific classes of persons who are ineligible. So if they are undertaking that all these conditions are getting fulfilled, then there is no restriction. They may penalize if the declaration is false.
Okay, Anjali, is approval of shareholder required for conversion of loan into equity?
Yes, sir. Required.
Okay. Can issuance of FCD under preferential allotment to promoter will cover under the takeover relaxation at the time of conversion, Manoj?
If it happens within this financial year, then 10% limit will be applicable. It happens after the financial year, then 5% creeping limit will be applicable. But initial threshold of 25% is still intact, so it will be applicable.
Okay, and last two questions. Can a company make preferential allotment of same security to different allottees at different price, Anjali?
Yes, sir, we can do that. No. We need to make disclosure in the notice. We can do that.
No, let regulator should.
No, two different prices, how it will happen? Because when you have this 26 weeks low, how two different prices will come at the same level?
That's the minimum price, sir.
She's saying minimum price I can fix is 52 rupees is coming the price, and I'm giving to Manoj a 70 and Anjali to 52.
It's a commercial transaction between two people. If Manoj feels comfortable ki 70 rupees will become 1000 rupees, he's willing to take up at 70 rupees.
Right. Okay.
This is my view.
But does it mean promoter will take at lower price and outsider will take higher price? Or promoter is taking it higher price and outsider is taking lower price? Or there are 10 promoters, or one promoter you are giving it one price, another promoter giving a different price?
You cannot give to less price to promoter, or you can give to less price to promoter but outsider higher price. Both are the issues which has to be seen in the different aspects. Okay, very interesting question. While computing the price, do we have to see calendar week or relevant dates day backward? Is the confusion.
No, it's not calendar week. It's the relevant date. Whenever the relevant date is, say it falls on Wednesday today, from Tuesday onwards, we'll be starting to compute the week, Tuesday backwards.
Manoj, this is FEMA related. Is there any restriction under FEMA for preferential allotment to foreign investors?
Generally, there is no restriction. We have to see the threshold under which company falls, industrial threshold. If the industry is under automatic, 100% automatic, then there will be no restriction. Then there is a new press note with respect to neighboring countries. If the beneficial owner, ultimate beneficial owner is from any of these countries, like China or some China, Pakistan, Bhutan, Bangladesh, then prior approval will be required from DIPT.
Okay, okay. So in a way, thank you very much. I have covered all 50 questions which I have received from the public. There is one question which has come. I can just give this answer. Can issuance of FCD under preferential allotment to promoter will cover under the takeover relaxation at the time of conversion, Manoj?
I think we have discussed this. Conversion is the trigger point. So we have to see if it is happening within this financial year, for which the relaxation of 10% is given, then it will not trigger open offer. If the conversion happens beyond March 2021, then there will be only 5% creeping limit, and accordingly it will be changed.
Okay, okay. Thank you very much to all panelists, Girish Joshi ji, for participating and giving us the clarity. Anjali for explaining the things, and Manoj for giving answer on regulatory takeover, FEMA, income tax valuation, and various other things. So thank you very much. And I think at the time also, we have exceeded the time because of the questions as received. I thank all of you, and I want to just inform everybody that thanks all participants to patiently listening and participating in a large number. Our next webinar on 26 June, that is on the insolvency law, is not there for the time being. So what will happen in place of insolvency law? That is the new topic which we are covering, and the insolvency law resolution, and in the absence of IBC, what are the recovery procedure is available, that we are having on 26 June at same time. Then 3rd July, we are having an insider law brief and recent case studies. 10th July, we are having a best time of the deal. This is the time to do the deal. Why and how? 10th July, and then we are having a 17th July, we are organizing program on family settlement, because case studies on how the family settlement will take place. Then next program will be AIF and the black money, that is Mr. Rakesh Gupta, our partner, will take. So thank you very much, friend, for participating. So all those who are participating, if you can send questions in advance, we can structure properly and we can remove the duplicate questions and we can give more answer. Though we have given all the answer, if in case anybody has is thinking that his answer is not properly or clearly answered, they can send mail to us. We will reply back to you immediately. So thank you very much, friends. Thanks for participating. Thank you, Anjali. Thank you, Griji. Thank you, Manoj.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.